Today we will discuss about hyperkalemia. Hyperkalemia is one of the most important cause for death in emergency rooms. So definition of hyperkalemia is whenever your potassium is high more than 5.5 milligrams, we clinically call it as hyperkalemia. Before that, we should understand how the potassium is produced in your body, how it is excreted. So normally when we take fresh fruit juices, fresh fruits, all these things, we get large amount of potassium to our body. Okay. Normally when we have adequate potassium, kidney will try to remove potassium. If the kidneys are damaged or something inside our body which regulates potassium have a defect, patient can have a hyperkalemia. Okay, so we'll see what are the causes of hyperkalemia in our clinical practice. Whenever you see a hyperkalemia, the most important cause must be, or it has to be, renal failure. What in clinical practice, what we see mostly is renal failure. A patient can have acute renal failure or chronic renal failure. Patient can have defective potassium excretion through the kidneys, so potassium can be elevated. So think about hyperkalemia. First thing is renal failure. Okay, then you know that some of our patients who is having hypertension, we will be putting on spironolactone. That is a potassium sparing agent that can have some potassium prevention of potassium loss through kidneys. Hypoaldosteronism is another cause for hyperkalemia. AC inhibitors and trimethoprim, all these drugs all sometimes can produce hyperkalemia. But remember, the most common cause for, most important cause for reduced renal excretion of potassium is acute or chronic renal failure. Okay. Now we'll see other causes of hyperkalemia. One is increased intake. Somebody is taking more amount of potassium, especially who is having renal failure. Suppose you take a large amount of fruit juices and with a renal failure, you can have high potassium. So IV fluid containing high potassium can produce hyperkalemia. High potassium containing diet can produce hyperkalemia. Packed cells, after transfusion of packed cells, you can have hyperkalemia. Hemolysis can release potassium. But all these things, you should remember that when you have a normal kidney, it is very, very difficult to have a hyperkalemia. Then next important cause for hyperkalemia is tissue breakdown. So you have a bleeding into the body cavities, hemolysis, rhabdomyolysis. After trauma, you can have, some patients can have high potassium. But even then, remember, if you have a normal kidney, all these conditions will not produce a clinically important hyperkalemia. Another important cause, but it is rare, that shift of potassium out of cells. That one of the most common causes is metabolic acidosis. In patient with metabolic acidosis, buffering of excess hydrogen ion in the cells leads to potassium shift into the ECF. So metabolic acidosis is one of the common cause for shift hyperkalemia. Then hyperkalemic periodic paralysis, suddenly patient develops flaccid paralysis because of high potassium. That's called as hyperkalemic periodic paralysis. Rarely beta blockers can produce hyperkalemia, but normal clinical setting it never happens. Digoxin toxicity is another cause for hyperkalemia. This is due to dose dependent inhibition of the sodium potassium ATPase pump. So common cause for shift hyperkalemia is metabolic acidosis, hyperkalemic periodic paralysis, high dose of beta blocker and digoxin toxicity. Remember that digoxin toxicity is very, very common because many patients are on digoxin. That patient can come with hyperkalemic problem. Okay. Now we'll see what are the clinical problems of hyperkalemia. Normally when you have a slightly elevated potassium, normal patients may have some symptoms. But what is a common clinical scenario is patient is having chronic renal failure. They are adapted to that high potassium for their body. So normally they never present with symptoms of hyperkalemia, but even then there can be some symptoms. So high potassium in an acute settings, they can have severe muscle weakness, like hyperkalemic periodic paralysis, flaccid muscle weakness. So they can have hyperreflexia, progressive ascending paralysis, all these things are common. Then this paralysis can extend to respiratory muscles, so they can have respiratory weakness. Then bradycardia is one of the most important striking clinical feature of hyperkalemia. So remember that a renal failure patient who come with bradycardia, think about hyperkalemia as a first clinical diagnosis. And cardiac arrhythmia, that will come to next step. Okay, so whenever you have a patient with suspected hyperkalemia, like for example, renal failure patient come with bradycardia, you are going to take an ECG. That is the first investigation you do. So we'll see what happens in a ECG according to the potassium levels. You already know that normal potassium level may be 3.5 to 4.5 or 5 milliequivalents per liter. When it is more than 6 to 7 milliequivalents, you get tall, very tall peak P waves, T waves, and short QR interval. The T waves are very tall, we call it as peak tall T waves. This is very classically seen in hyperkalemia, but you remember that the same change can occur in the hyperacute MI also. But remember, in hyperkalemia, these T waves are universal. You get in all leads, but acute MI, it is confined to some leads like V1, V2, V3, V4. You think about acute anterior wall MI. But if you are getting in all 12 leads or 11 leads, you think about hyperkalemia. If it is potassium levels are 7 to 8 milliequivalents, then you see that loss of P waves. Remember, first is tall T waves. Now you lose the P waves from the ECG and you get a wide QRS. So tall T waves first step, then you lose P wave, then you get a void QRS complex. If it is 8 to 10 milliequivalents, it is not very common in clinical practice, then you see sine waves. That means there is no P wave, void QRS and tall T waves. Finally, it will become a wave, something like a sine. Okay, that is called a sine P wave. And if it is more than 9 milliequivalents, you get ventricular tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, cardiac arrest. But remember, in a patient who is having chronic renal failure, who comes with either tall T waves or bradycardia, you have to think about hyperkalemia as a first differential diagnosis. So remember, tall T waves are first and foremost clinical finding in ECG, and you get finally, ultimately, sine wave. Okay. Now we'll see how to manage a hyperkalemia case. Okay. Important step in management of hyperkalemia is potassium increases, you get arrhythmias. We already discussed that patient can have arrhythmias. So prevention of cardiac arrhythmia is one of the most important step in the management of hyperkalemia. So you can give, for as a first step, you have to give calcium gluconate. Injection calcium gluconate should be given 10% solution, 10 ml over 10 minutes. Remember, injection calcium gluconate 10%, 10 ml over 10 minutes. Everything is 10. So you give calcium gluconate. Calcium gluconate decreases the membrane excitability. That is a cause for arrhythmia. So give calcium gluconate as a first step. And the onset of the action of these calcium gluconates start in minutes and last for 30 to 60 minutes. So 1 hour you can have time. By the time you have to give other treatment. So whenever you get a hyperkalemia with ECG change or muscle weakness, first step is always give calcium gluconate 10 cc, 10 ml, 10% should be given over 10 minutes. Okay, now we'll see what is the next step. Now you have to look for how to shift the potassium into the cells, because in the blood it is creating problem. Now you have to push the potassium into the cells. You can use insulin dextrose infusion. Okay, you dilute 100 ml dextrose with 10 units of insulin and give it over like 10 to 15 minutes you give, and this can shift the potassium into the cells. But remember, many patients with diabetic nephropathy can have very high blood sugar. So it is impossible to give a dextrose insulin infusion. You give only insulin. Or somebody is having hypoglycemia with hyperkalemia, it is difficult to give insulin on that setting. So you avoid insulin. Both insulin and dextrose can shift the potassium into the cells. So no need to worry, you give either insulin or 50% dextrose or 25 to 50% dextrose, 100 ml dextrose with 10 units insulin should be given as an early step, and it may last, the effect of this may last for 4 to 6 hours. So what we have given first is we have given calcium gluconate that may act for first 1 hour, then you give insulin dextrose infusion that may act for another 4 hours, but repeated doses can be given during the treatment. Okay, now the third important treatment is bicarbonate, but bicarbonate should be reserved for patients with cardiac arrest. Hyperkalemia with cardiac arrest or hyperkalemia with severe metabolic acidosis, bicarbonates are very useful. Otherwise, bicarbonate will not be giving in the as a first line treatment for hyperkalemia. I'll tell the dose. IV sodium bicarbonate 7.5%, 50 to 100 ml is given in as a bolus over 10 to 20 minutes, followed by IV bicarbonate as a drip. Okay, so you can give IV soda bicarb, sodium bicarbonate, that will also shift the potassium, but reserve it only for cardiac arrest or patient is having very, very severe metabolic acidosis. Okay, now we'll talk about next step. There is salbutamol. Salbutamol is given as a nebulization form. You know that many patients with asthma, we give salbutamol nebulization. One of the common side effects of salbutamol nebulization is hypokalemia. But remember that we have to give very high dose of salbutamol nebulization. You have to give 10 to 20 milligram in 4 ml of saline, should be nebulized over 10 minutes, and it can be repeated 4 to 8 times during the treatment, but it is a very high dose of salbutamol nebulization comparing to asthma treatment. Now we understood that we can either shift the potassium into the cells, or you can stabilize the membrane as a first step. Now the third important step is, or sometimes we use it as a first line or second line treatment, that is removal of potassium from the body. Okay, we give main drug is furosemide, that means LASIX. So we give furosemide to remove water from the body. Along with the water, you can remove the potassium also. So you give 80 to 100 mg of LASIX or furosemide as an IV bolus, so that patient can have patient body fluid and potassium will be removed. Suppose the patient is not passing urine and you are unable to give LASIX and potassium is not removed from the body, then this patient should be taken for dialysis. Dialysis is the one of the most important treatment where you have a resistant hyperkalemia. So dialysis can remove potassium. The last step in management of hyperkalemia, you use cation exchange resins, like that is something which can be given as an enema or chassé, that will prevent the absorption of potassium. That is sodium polystyrene sulfonate. It is available as 15 gram chassé. You give 3 times, that will prevent the absorption of potassium from the intestine, but that is not coming under the acute management. It comes under the management in ward. It can be given as as a chassé or a enema can be given. So I hope that you understood the management of hyperkalemia. Hyperkalemia is one of the most common clinical problem which come across in the patient when you manage a patient of renal failure, chronic renal failure. Remember that acute hyperkalemia or acute renal failure produces more problem than chronic hyperkalemia or chronic renal failure. So these patients, acute hyperkalemia should be managed very fast than a chronic renal failure. But the management, I am again pointing out the points of management. You give calcium gluconate, you give furosemide, you give soda bicarb in arrest or severe acidosis, and if the patient is not improving, you can again give insulin dextrose infusion, and if the patient is not improving, you have to take this patient for dialysis. Thank you.